And I declare right now, Father, that you will break on our behalves. I have nothing to say unless you say it, God. We honor you and we reverence you for this opportunity in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. Amen. Y'all praise God in this place. Before you sit down, I want you to look at a few people around you and tell them trouble don't last always. Well, we got to do it. We got to do it. Rev, you better help me today.
Hmm.
Let's do it. Trouble.
Don't last always.
Trouble don't. Trouble don't last always. I need my babies. Y'all take off, babies. Go, baby. Y'all get a baby's hand. Good God. Good God. Hallelujah. Trouble don't last always. I remember reading a quote that said something like this, you guys. It said, tough times don't last, but tough people do. Tough times don't last, but tough people do. And can I suggest something to each and every individual that's under the sound of my voice, that your suffering has an expiration date.
All right.
Amen. Your suffering has an expiration date. My suffering has an expiration date. Each and every last one of our sufferings has an expiration date. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1, verse 3, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. Yeah. This is talking about Jesus. After his suffering, he gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. Everybody say, after my suffering.
After
my suffering. When I was younger, I would never forget that I would hear the preacher, Rev, and I would hear my mom and my grandmother. They would always say things like this: when you're down to nothing,
God is up to something.
They mean God is up to something. When you're, and I didn't understand it at the time. I didn't understand it at the time, but after I suffered a little while. Hallelujah. After I suffered just a little while, he established me and he made me strong.
Amen.
Trouble.
Amen.
Don't last.
Amen.
Always. Hallelujah. I want you to start off by going to John chapter 16, verse 33. Real, for some reason, I feel that old time coming up in me today. Real, I promise I really do. Because as I sit back and I think about everything that I've been through, I can't help but thank the Father. I can't help but thank him. Because of everything that I've been through, because of trial, because of hardship, because of difficulty, trouble. It don't last. It don't last always. Hey, John chapter 16, verse 33. John chapter 16. Verse 33, Lord help me. Thank you, Father. Raise your hand if you need this kind of word today. Amen. Hallelujah. We need some encouragement going into this new year. This is the last month of December. This is the last month of 2022. Amen. John chapter 16, verse 33. That's okay, too. That's okay. Oh, okay. I was going to do it. I have told you these things. This is Jesus speaking. This should be your red letters. I have told you these things so that in me, everybody say in me.
In me.
I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. John 15, verse 5. He said in me. That means that I'm in position with him. That's in relation to him. But apart from him, I can do absolutely nothing.
Amen.
Watch this. With him, I can do all things. Without him, I can do nothing. I have told you these things so that in me you may do what, you guys? Lord God. In me you may have peace. Everybody say peace. 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 This peace that it's talking about right here, if you break it down in the Greek connotation, is arene. Everybody say arene. 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 Arene is a national state of tranquility. A national state of tranquility. It means to be exempt from the rage and the havoc of war. Means to be exempt from the rage and the havoc of war. Now, it never said that the war is not going on. You're just exempt from it because you're a child of the living God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
This is the peace that it's talking about. And this is a peace that surpasses all
understanding.
understanding, according to Philippians chapter 4, verse 7. In this church.
This world.
Because we believe that as believers, we shouldn't have any problems. Oh, I go to church, everything good. I dot every I, I cross every T. God, I'm good. I'm holy, and nothing should come near my dwelling. False. Do you know that the enemy will crank it up 7 times hotter because you are a believer?
Amen.
Everybody say prove it. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The furnace was turned up how? 7 times hotter. So be prepared, because the enemy is going to do everything that he possibly can to throw everything at you except for the kitchen sink, and he might throw that too. In this world, these are the systems that are designed to keep God out. The systems that are designed to keep God out. That's the cosmos that it's talking about. In this world, you might have.
You will.
Uh-oh. It's inevitable. It's unavoidable. It's certain to happen. You will have trouble. But take heart. Be courageous. I have done what, you guys? I have overcome the world.
Amen.
I have overcome the world. If Jesus has overcome the world, why do we succumb to the world? If Jesus has overcome the world as a believer, why am I succumbing to the world? I want to focus. I want to blend in. I want to be like this rapper, and I want to be like that preacher, and I want to be like that business person. But God has not called you to fit in. He's called you to stand out.
Amen.
Come on. In this world. In this world, you will have trouble. You will have tribulation. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. I have conquered it. I have conquered the world. See, the Bible says in Isaiah 66, verse 1, that heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus has conquered it. He said, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. My footstool. My footstool. Anytime you think about a footstool, if you go and you actually study out how much a footstool costs. My kid costs anywhere from $9.99 to $30.
Yeah.
That's something that's beneath me. That's a footstool. He said, earth is my footstool.
Yeah.
And heaven is my throne. Heaven is my throne. So there are some things. There's some things that are on top of you, and you should have your foot on his neck.
That's right.
It's on top of you. You're along the weight of it. You're along the pressure of it. And you're succumbing to it. I'm succumbing to the latest fads. I'm succumbing to the latest trends. I'm succumbing to all of these different things. But it's time for me to rise up in boldness and say, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Joel 13, verse 15. And as a believer, we believe that we won't have hardship. As a believer, we believe that we won't have difficulties. Raise your hand if you ever heard somebody say that God won't put more on you than you can bear. Raise your hand if you ever heard that before. God won't put more on you than you can bear. Can I suggest something to you? I'm not going to even suggest it to you. I'm going to make it so crystal clear to you that that's not in the scripture. He said he won't allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear.
That's right. Amen.
But with the temptation, he provides a way of escape. He provides a way out, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. Is this making sense to y'all?
Amen.
Because anything that the Father calls you to is going to be more than you can bear, because you need the backing of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
He won't put more on me than I can bear. It's not in the scripture. That's a lyric by Kirk Franklin. And we do a phenomenal job in the body of Christ of quoting lyrics, but we can't quote a scripture. We do a phenomenal job at quoting the lyrics of a song and twisting them up. You know the Bible said, no, it does not say that. Show me that in the scripture, because it's not there. It's not there. Is this making sense to y'all? Trouble. Trouble don't last. It don't last always. It doesn't last always. Trouble is the quality or state of being troubled, especially mentally. Everybody say mentally.
Mentally.
It's difficulty or problems. The synonym for trouble is anxiety, concern, danger, dilemma, disorder, disturbance, inconvenience, and hardship. Raise your hand if you've been through any one of them before. Hallelujah. You qualify then. You qualify. I qualify. We qualify. Each and every last one of us qualify. I was getting some greens the other day, you know, hang out, because I don't plant gardens. Hallelujah. I don't plant gardens at all, Gerald. Not at all. Not at all. And I love the wisdom of the old season saints. I love the wisdom of it. Right across the street. Right across the street, Israel. I have my neighbor. He called me over. He said, hey. I said, yes, sir. Yes, sir. I come begging him because I know he got some kind of nugget for me. He hands me a bag of greens and he said, when you go and cook these greens, he said, make sure you wash them first.
Yeah.
He said, wash these greens. He said, because you know,
real good.
We ain't trouble free.
Yeah. Right.
He said, it may be some critters in there. We ain't trouble free.
Amen.
He said something and it really resonated to me. He said, you know what? We ain't trouble free. And I thought about something, you guys, in the body of Christ. I just want y'all to know that we ain't trouble free.
Amen.
Not this state of heaven. Not this side of heaven. I don't care what the situation is. I don't care what season you're in. We ain't trouble free. We ain't trouble free. There's going to be some things that you have to walk through. The Bible says many. Everybody say many.
Amen.
Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Psalms 34 verse 19. You're going to have to walk through some hardships. You're going to have to go through some difficulties. You're going to have to go through some trial times because we ain't trouble free. We ain't trouble free. We ain't trouble free. I remember Rev, that football was all I ever wanted to do. And I remember coming down to my last game, and I knew it was my last game. They didn't even have to tell me it was my last game.
All right.
They had to tell me it was my last game because the season that I was walking through, I knew that I had outgrown it. See, it is possible for you to be talented. It is possible for you to be gifted. But one thing that you have to understand, that just like it says in the Bible, don't wear out your welcome.
Yeah, for real.
I was trying to play football longer than I knew the grace of God was on my life for me to play that.
Yeah.
It was time for me to step into a new phase because God was gracing me in a new season.
Yeah.
He was gracing me for something else. So I remember the last game of my season, we're playing against a rival team, Southeastern Oklahoma, and I'm running the ball and things like that. And guess what? I couldn't move like I used to move. I couldn't. I couldn't move around. I couldn't. And I felt something. I felt that my heart wasn't in it like it used to be in it. I felt like I had to force things. Raise your hand if you have to force something sometimes.
Yeah.
Raise your hand if you feel like you have to force some situations. I felt like I had to force it just to be here because I have my name attached to this. Everybody that knows me, they know me pertaining to sports. Everybody that knows me, they know me. I get my identity from this. I don't know what to do, and I don't know how to function without this. So I get the ball on one of the last times I grabbed the ball. The dude kept hitting me right in front of the ref, and they blowing the whistle, but not on my behalf. They were blowing the whistle on their board. So I said, man, you know what? I said, Lord, if I ain't say Lord, because I know I wasn't saying Lord at that time. Jesus is the Christ. I was not saying that at the time. So what ended up happening was I was saying some stuff I probably ain't had no business saying, probably in my mind, but I already had a made up mind. I said, you know what? If they do this and they hit me off the whistle again, I'm finna do something out here.
Yeah.
I'm from Eagle Lake, Texas. Go to right here. You ain't finna just do me no way. Hey, everybody say BC. Oh, Christ. So I ended up getting the ball, and as soon as I got the ball, he hit me again after the whistle. I picked the ball up, not like this. I picked the ball up like this, and I, boom, I threw the ball and hit the man in his face mask.
Good.
I threw it, and I hit him in his face mask. And as a result of that, yeah. Flags go up everywhere. And they ain't finna get ready to fight out there. I'm sitting back, y'all. Better not hit me. And I realized that season of my life was over. But see, deep down, they didn't know that I was struggling with just losing my mom. Deep down, they didn't know that I was struggling with the weight of coming back to Eagle Lake, Texas, empty-handed. They didn't know that I was struggling with the weight of what has been put on me ever since I was a child. I felt like that if I didn't make it, then I was a failure. I felt like if I didn't make it, then I'm not only letting myself down, but I'm letting everybody else down. And That's when I had to get broken free from people pleasing, just like each and every last one of you do. Because God may have something greater for you on the other side. Stop trying to force it all the time. When a season and when a grace is over in one season, you ask God what grace is upon your life for the next season.
Amen.
Is this making sense to y'all?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Everybody say trouble don't last always.
Trouble don't last always.
2 Corinthians chapter 4. Start at verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Let's start at verse 17. Hallelujah. 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 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. Are y'all being blessed so far?
Amen.
Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. For our light and momentary troubles or afflictions are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. For our light, everybody say light.
Light,
that means that they're light in weight. They're light in weight. They're light in momentary afflictions. Momentarily means that it's a set point in time. It has a time frame. The Bible says weeping may endure for a night, but joy.
Amen.
It comes.
Amen.
It comes in the morning. It comes in the morning in Psalms 30, verse 5. Weeping may endure for a night, you guys. Just a night, but joy comes in the morning. He said, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Go to the next verse for me. Go to the next verse. So we fix our eyes on social media because that's reality. Do you know that social media causes the most depression out of anything else? Why? Because you're trying to keep up with that individual and keep up with that individual. And then before you know it, you've lost yourself trying to be somebody else. So we fix our eyes not on what it is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is what, you guys?
Temporary.
It's temporary. But what is unseen is what?
Eternal.
We focus so much on this instead of walking by this. We focus so much on our physical five senses, what we can see, touch, taste, smell, and hear. But can I suggest something to you? That without faith, it's impossible to please the Lord.
Amen.
Hebrews 11 verse 6. We have to make sure that we're walking by faith and we don't find ourselves in the realm of the flesh, because those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God, according to Romans 8 verse 8. Is this making sense to y'all? So in the midst of these situations, we have to make sure that we're optimistic and not pessimistic.
Yeah,
that's right. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Optimistic, meaning having a hopeful confidence in your future. A hopeful confidence in your future and not pessimistic. Everybody say pessimistic. Some big words. Y'all gonna be like, what is wrong? Yeah, pessimistic, pessimistic, pessimistic. Watch this. It's the anticipation of a negative outcome. As a believer, you always got a negative mind frame about things.
Hallelujah.
Instead of walking by faith and instead of calling those things that be not as though they were, according to Romans 4:17, well, you know what? I just got to go and receive this. No, you don't. You don't have to receive it, because if the Bible says it, then that means that heaven is backing it.
Amen.
Let me say that one more time. If the Bible says it, that means that heaven is backing it. Is this making sense to y'all?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. 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 I remember when I was younger, and I used to love going to church, and I'm gonna be honest with you, Red, my highlight of church was probably that choir.
All
right. Man, it just did something to my soul back then in those times when I would listen to some of these songs when I was going through what I was going through. Even at a young age, I had an old soul. Had an old soul. And I remember one song in particularly that stood out to me even at a young age when I was going through what I was going through. When I had abandonment issues, when I had a rejection issues, when I was going through these things. But the Bible says that the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was a song that came on. I want you to turn that up for me. Turn it on up for me. I remember this song right here, y'all. Yeah, boy. Hallelujah. I want y'all to just listen to the words real quick for me. Listen with me, listen with me. This is one of the songs that helped me through when I was going through what I was going through at a young age. He said, hold on. He said, hold on. Hold on. Everybody just say, hold on. See, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23, to hold fast to the profession of your faith without wavering. Hold fast to the profession of your faith without wavering. The enemy will do anything he possibly can to get you to lose hope. He wants you to lose hope, because if he can get you to lose hope, he'll get you to surrender. He'll get you to back up. He'll get you to leave and go outside in the world. And then do you understand that the enemy has a field day with the believers in particularly? Because what ends up happening is we'll end up going out in the world when God does, when we feel like God has done us wrong. And then we come right back in the church whenever we're feeling good. And if somebody do us wrong in the church, we're going right back out in the world. And if the world ain't good to us, we're coming back into the church again. Do y'all see that cycle? Do y'all see now that I just brought that into your room? Y'all like, man, that was really silly. How goofy of me. And each and every last one of us live those type of lives. If so, sister so-and-so didn't speak to me today, so I'm going to do her the same way she did me, in Jesus' name. And as a result of that, boom, you're going right back out in the world. And then you go right back in the world, and they did you some kind of way. And then you out there, man, I got to get my life right. We laughing about those situations, but do you know that the enemy has us in those little yo-yos? Yeah. Like a dog chasing his tail. Yeah. See, the Bible declares in Proverbs 26, verse 11, it says, as a dog returns to his vomit, so the fool repeats his foolishness. As a dog returns to his vomit, so the fool repeats his foolishness. We've done some foolish things. We've acted foolishly. We've acted unbecomingly. But God was still there to welcome us back with open arms. Everybody say, trouble don't last that long. It don't last that long. It don't last always. It don't last. Always, I want you to go.
Hallelujah.
To Mark chapter 4, verse 35. Flow, Holy Spirit. Mark chapter 4.
Hallelujah.
Mark chapter 4, verse 35. Mark chapter 4, verse 35. That day, when evening came, he said, everybody say, Jesus said.
Jesus.
To his disciples, a disciple is a pupil, it's the disciplined learners. Let us go over, where are you guys?
To the other side.
Is that his promise?
Yeah.
That is promise? His promise is that we are going over to the other side, because if Jesus said it, then that settles it.
Yeah.
If Jesus said it, then that settles it. That settles the issue. Let's go to the next verse, you guys. Leaving the crowd behind. And then it has a comma right there, so we don't want you to rush past that. That's a pause. Everybody say pause. Leaving the crowd behind.
Amen.
Can I suggest something to you? That a lot of your troubles and a lot of storms you in is because you won't leave the crowd behind. A lot of situations that we're going through, a lot of hardships and a lot of difficulties, we're bringing them upon ourselves because we're trying to be ride or dies. We're trying to be too faithful. But I never rat you out, cuz, and you the cheese. See, you don't realize that what loyalty is, Loyalty is when you have my back behind my back. Loyalty is when you have my back behind my back.
Yes.
Yeah, don't you come up and tell me what somebody said about me. Yeah. The first thing I'm going to ask you is, what did you say to him? Yeah. What did you do? Did you hold me down? Did you hold your pastor down? No. Such was some of you. Let me stop. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. Let's go to the next verse. A furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly what, you guys? Swamp. Now let me ask you a question. Who brought this squall? Who brought this storm? Was it God who brought this storm? No, it was the enemy who brought the storm. But the first thing that we do when we get into trouble, the first thing that we do is try to point fingers at the Father. Lord, why did you allow this to happen? Why did you cause this to happen? Let me suggest something to you. A lot of things, God doesn't cause it, but he will allow it. He doesn't cause it, but he will allow it. And in the midst of him allowing that situation, he is saying, you know what? I'm causing all things to work together for the good of those who love the Lord.
Amen, brother.
And that are called for his purpose, according to his purpose. That's not for everybody. Hallelujah. That's for those who love the Lord. How do I know I love him? I love him by keeping his commands. John 14, verse 15. Is this making sense to y'all? Let's go to the next verse. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a sealy posture, Peter. Head on a cushion. Boy, it was so specific. He was letting you know that he was sleeping. But then you get the people who try to come up, Andy, they try to come up and debate you. But he got, how was he sleeping? Because he neither sleeps nor slumbers. They'll hit you with that, D. He never sleeps nor slumbers. No, he doesn't sleep nor slumber in his divinity, but Jesus was in his humanity right here. That's why you got to read in context. That's why you got to read the word of God in context, because you have a lot of people that are debating, how can they hear without a preacher? How can he preach lest he be sent? Yes, you need to assemble. Yes, you need to assemble. Yes, you need to be in the koinonia, the fellowship, the body of Christ. Somebody pulled that from me right there. Amen. Jesus was in the stern sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, teacher. Every time you see teacher, be prepared, because that means that a teachable moment is about to follow. Teacher, don't you care if we what?
We drown.
Don't you care if we drown? Now watch this. Watch this. They on the boat with G. They on the boat with G. They on the boat with G. They on the boat with him. He's sleeping and they still scared. We laugh at that, but we the same way. In the boat, in the vessel with him. And we still scared. God, you don't care about me. And he right here in arm's length. Lord, you don't care about me. See, we laugh about it as I paint that picture, but we're like that all of the time and don't even realize it. Amen. We fleece the Father. Everybody say fleece him. Fleece him, fleece him, fleece him. We fleece him all the time. Lord, 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 if it's you, then do this for me. Lord, if it's you, then do that for me. Lord, I know you came through this time, but Lord, if you can give me one more sign. Yeah. Lord, this time I want you to cause a pelican to land on my roof. We laugh about those things, but I'm telling you, we fleece the Father that same exact way, and we have to operate by faith, you guys. Is this making sense to y'all?
Yes. Amen.
The disciples woke him and said to him, teacher, don't you care if we drown? Let's go to the next verse. God, paint your picture. He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves. So he rebuked what he couldn't see and spoke to what he could see. Jesus rebuked what he couldn't see and spoke to what he could see. And we have that same life-giving spirit dwelling on the inside of us. We allow a lot of these tumultuous waves to rise up until the boat is swamped in our lives without us even speaking back. Well, Lord, I thought it. No. When you pray, say, Luke 11, verse 2, you better open your mouth and you better give God glory in the midst of your hardships and in the midst of your difficulties, in the midst of your trials. All he is looking for is the word, because angels hearken to the voice of his word. Psalms 103 verse 20. Y'all got me preaching. Is this making sense to y'all?
Amen.
He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the wave, quiet or peace, be still. Amen. Then the wave did what, you guys?
The wind died down.
It didn't say before. It said then. That means that he had to open his mouth first. He had to speak, and then the wind died down. And it was completely calm. Now go back to verse 38 for me. Go back to verse 38. Go back to verse 38. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples did what, you guys? They woke him and said to him, teacher, don't you care if we drown? Now let me ask you a question. Who is Jesus? Who is Jesus to you? He's your Savior. Who is he in this context? He's the Savior. Who else is he? Hiya. Huh? He's the teacher. Said he's the teacher. Absolutely. But he's somebody else, y'all. Who else is he? Huh? Yeah, he's a protector. He's all of that. He's all of that. But in a sense, it said that the disciples woke him. They woke him. John chapter 1, verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was with God. And he was with God in the beginning. John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. So what the disciples did in the midst of this situation is they woke up the Word. They woke the Word up. They woke the Word. When you're in a storm, when you're in hardship, when you're in difficulties, you better wake up the Word. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, wake up the Word. Where I shall live and not die, to declare the words of the Lord. Though he slay me, yet shall I trust him. Oh, for my light and momentary troubles are achieving for me in eternal glory, which far outweighs them all. Oh, God, you're faithful. God, you're holy. I lift my hands in the sanctuary and I praise the Lord. I got to wake up the Word in the midst of everything that I'm going through. Everybody say they woke the Word. They woke. They woke. They woke. They woke the Word. They woke the Word. Let me teach a little bit. I ain't hear this in a minute. They have some different types of storms. They have some different types of storms. The first type of storm is a storm that is a part of nature. It's just a part of life. It's a part of life. It's a part of life. Sometimes it's not caused by the enemy. And sometimes it's not caused by Satan. It's just life. Tell your neighbor and say, life happens.
Life happens.
Life happens. But in the midst of life happening, God will still cause that mess and turn it into a miracle for you.
Amen.
Because he's looking for the posture of your heart. That's what he's looking for. He's trying to make sure that your heart is intact. He's trying to make sure that your motives are right. He's trying to make sure that your attitude is right. What is an attitude? A settled way of thinking. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Proverbs 23, verse 7. Is it making sense to y'all? The first storm is the storms that are part of nature. They're just a part of life. Watch this. The second storm. Everybody say the second storm. The second storm are the storms that we bring upon ourselves. The storms that we bring upon ourselves through disobedience. We bring these storms upon ourselves through disobedience, and then we point the finger at the Father. See, the Bible says that he is the Spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. Ephesians 2, 2. He is, and it's talking about Satan. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. And that's referred to as a son of disobedience. A son or a daughter of disobedience. This is making sense to y'all. Everybody say the next storm. The next storm is the storm of development. God has you in the storm just to develop you. Raise your hand if you've been in some storms and you're like, man, golly, Lord, I know I'm doing what I'm tithing, I'm fasting, I'm praying. Why in the world are all these hardships coming my way? Because God is developing you. He's building you. He's molding you. See, the Bible says in Psalms 119, verse 71, it was good for me that I was afflicted so that I may learn your precepts. Sometimes it's good for you to go through these certain situations. God will never take you from mountaintop to mountaintop. He'll take you from mountaintop back down to the valley, back up to the mountaintop again. That's the way the Father operates. But when in the midst of that situation, in the midst of those dry and those desolate places, you still have to count it all joy.
Right.
Is this blessing y'all this morning? Amen. It's building me up. It's building me up. It's building me up. Hallelujah. And the next storm is the storm that we're dragged into by other people. The storms that we're dragged into by other individuals. The Bible says those who walk with the wise will become wise. Those who walk with fools will suffer harm.
Yep.
Those those who walk with the wise will be wise, and those who walk with fools will, not might, suffer harm.
Amen.
You don't have to be a fool to suffer harm. All you got to do is walk with them.
Right.
Proverbs 13, verse 20. We were my first year at junior college. First year of junior college, I was in up close to Abilene, Texas, about 5 hours, 6 hours away from Eagle Lake, Texas. So Cisco Junior College. Ended up going up there, and they had a rival school. Rival school by the name of Ranger Junior College. Man, look, I was really a cool dude. I was never really, really built to just go out there and just cause any type of ruckus. That just wasn't me. But because the people that was on the squad with me, just because they said, man, let's squad up and go over to Ranger. Good, let's go then. So I get in the car with him. We loaded down, almost the whole football team. And we ended up going over to Ranger Junior College. We had one dude was out there standing in a parking lot. So the dude looking out and they going in on him and talking crazy to him and stuff like that. We made a circle to try to get out. And as soon as we made a circle, I don't know what he did to make a call. But the entire junior college went out there, along with the president and staff members. And they had the car surrounded. And it was nothing but the grace of God that we got out of that situation. Trying to ride or die. Because we were about to die. We were going through those things, and I had to sit back. And I'm like, man, why in the world would I put myself in a situation like this? But I thank God that I had somebody praying for me. Because that could have went left. That could have went south. But I had somebody that was fasting for me. I had somebody that was praying for me. I had somebody that was on their face in my stead and on my behalf. Don't you thank God for people who praying for you? Storms that we get dragged into by other individuals. Is this making sense to y'all this morning? Is this word building y'all up? Hallelujah. 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 Had a guy come up to me the other day, you know, and I very seldomly go into stores and stuff like that. I let Shawana do all that because she like to do that. Don't smack, you do. So she you know, she usually does that for me a whole lot. She go to the stores and stuff like that. So, but this day in particular, I went into the store and it went for ice cream this time. I just went in the store, you know, and I'm standing at the register. A guy looked at me. He said, said, hey, man, how you doing? I said, man, I'm good, man. I said, how's everything going with you? He said, man, everything good. He said, how the family? I said, everybody good. And my eyes started turning up. I said, man, so everything straight with the, you know, family and everybody? I was like, everybody good. He said, you still a preacher? And I said, yeah. But I thought about some of you guys. He said, are you still? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Are you still a preacher? Are you still a preacher?
Why not?
I've been through some hardships. And even at that time, I was going through something. But I ain't let nobody see it. But he asked me, are you still a preacher? And let me tell you something. This is not an occupation. This is a calling.
That's right.
Amen, this is a call.
Amen.
I couldn't get out of this if I wanted to.
Sure.
Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 16, necessity is laid upon me. Yes, woe to me if I don't preach the gospel.
Yes,
he said necessity, it's an obligation. It's a must. Necessity is laid upon me.
Amen.
Jesus said in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 7, behold, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me to do thy will, O God. It is written of me to do thy will, O God. It is written of you to be a teacher. It is written of you to be a farmer. It is written of you to be a prophet. It is written of you to be a pastor. It is written of you to be a man of God. It is written of you to be a deacon. It is written of you to be a parent. It is written of you to be a mom, a dad, a grandmother. Whatever the Father has called you to be, it is written of you.
Amen.
And once it's written of you, it can't be washed off.
Amen.
Once it's written of you, it can't be taken away. Your heart has to burn for it. I don't care what type of troubling season that you're going through. You still have to understand that the Bible says that it is written of you.
Amen.
Yep.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
and it is written of me. Is this making sense to y'all? Everybody say, it's written of me. Yeah. It's written. Hallelujah. It's written of me. It's written of me. Shawan and I, you know, when we first got married, you know, we said, you know, we're not going to have a big wedding. You know, I know some people going to be upset, but we're not going to have a huge wedding. We're just going to sit down. We're going to invite a few people. You know, you invite your people. I'm going to invite some people. And so she finished her list, and you know, I invited the people that was close to me at that time, and so what ended up happening was I told her, I said, well, you know, where do you want to go? I said, you know what, we don't have a big wedding, so we can go wherever you want to go. We can, you know, put that money on going, taking a trip or something. So I thought it would be my wife and I, but the little girl that I had at the time said that she wanted to go to Georgia. Man, golly, why she got to make the decision for us? So she wanted to go to Spelman University. Mm-hmm. Spelman. They ain't play out too good there. I'm wasting my doggone money. You owe me. So she wanted to go out there. We took her to Spelman University. We did, you know, we ended up doing those type of things. Man, I'm out there in Georgia. And man, we actually loving the scenery. Everything was good, man. Everything was great. And so I began to start studying the Georgia peach tree. I guess, y'all look at me, but it's the nerd in me. You know, I'm a researcher. I absolutely love those things. And so I'm studying out the Georgia peach tree, and I discover something, you guys. I discover that the Georgia peach tree has to go through 1,000 hours of cold weather before it bears fruit. Oh, my God. It has to go through 1,000 hours of cold weather before it bears the proper fruit. And I thought about something in the body of Christ. We want everything to be perfect. We want perfect conditions. We want perfect climate. But the real growth takes place when it's cold outside. The real growth takes place when you have wetness outside, when the climate is looking the way it's looking, when it's foggy outside and there's no sunshine there. Because that's when the Father is stretching you beyond your normal capacity. Is this making sense to y'all this morning? Everybody say, I have to be stretched.
I have to be stretched.
I have to be stretched. I have to be stretched. I have to be stretched. Are y'all being blessed by this word? Golly, man. Golly. Thank you. Go to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. First Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18. Thank you, Lord. Timothy, this is Paul speaking to his understudy, Timothy. He says, Timothy, my son, I give you. Everybody say, I give you. I give you. Anytime you see the word give in scripture, that means that the law of grace is in effect. The law of grace is in effect. That means to freely transfer the possession of something to someone. He said, I give you this instruction in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that by following them, you may do what? Fight the what, you guys? That's why you receive a word of prophecy. You receive a word of prophecy so that you can fight the battle well. You receive a word of prophecy, not just to say, oh, Lord, they finna bless me with a new house. Lord, let me see if he can pray for me so I can get me a new car. No. The prophecies that you receive is so that you can fight the battle well. This gives you hope that there is an intended end because the Father is speaking to you through his anointed vessel. That's what you hold fast to. I have prophecies that have been spoken over my life all the way from 2013, and I still go back and replay them. I still go back and rehearse them, and I watch some of them unfold, and I'm like, Lord, look what you're doing. That's why you get a prophet. That's why you get a prophetic word. He said, I watch over my word to perform it. Every word is not his. That's true. He said, I watch over my word to perform it. So be mindful as of to who you allow to lay hands on you. Be mindful as of to who you allow to prophesy over you. I had somebody send me a text message the other day, a prophetic word. And guess what I didn't do? I didn't come into agreement with it. This was my response. I pulled on the wisdom of heaven, and this is what I said. The Lord's will be done. I said, the Lord's will be done. That didn't mean I said, yeah, I agree with you wholeheartedly. No. The Bible says to test all things, prove that which is true. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. It never says to trust all things. It says to test all things. I have to make sure that I test this word. Because before I receive a prophetic word from somebody, I have to know them that labor among me. Hey! 1 Thessalonians 5:12. Is this making sense to y'all? My God. Timothy, my son, I give you this instruction in keeping with the prophecy once made about you, so that by following them, you may fight the good fight. Even when you're going through trouble, you go back and you pull on those words. You go back and you pull on those words. Now I'm going to get ready to wrap it up right here. Now I'm going to ask each and every last one of you guys a question. Raise your hand if you pray throughout the week. Raise your hand if you fast when the Father puts it on your heart. Raise your hand if you even read your word. Good. Now, even though you do all of that, does the enemy ever mess with you to have you thinking that you're far away from God? I knew this was going to get y'all. Even though you do all of those things, does the enemy still come in and let you know, like, man, you ain't nowhere near where you're supposed to be? I want to help you right now. I want you to go to Matthew 27, verse 46. Matthew chapter 27, verse 46. And I'm going to get ready to wrap it up right here. Matthew 27, 46. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Now, all through Scripture, you see him referring to the God of heaven as Father. My Father loves me because I lay down my life only to have it back again. My teaching is not my own. It comes from the one who sent me. It's my father. But this is the only place in Scripture where you see Jesus addressing the Father as my God. The only place in Scripture where you see him addressing him as my God. Because at this time, the Father did not see his Son. He saw the sins of the world.
That's right. Amen.
And Jesus was smack dab in the middle of destiny. Smack dab in the middle of purpose. Smack dab in the middle of the will of God. And when he was in the middle of the will of God, he felt the furthest away.
Yep.
Right here in this scripture. He did everything that he was supposed to do up until this point. And he said, "My God, why have you forsaken me?" He did the fasting. He did the praying. He did the going to the synagogue. He did all of those different things, but he still felt far away from the Father. And I'm telling you right now to encourage each and every last one of you that I don't care how far away you seem. It's not about a feeling. You have to trust the Father even when you can't trace him.
Amen.
He's there for us, and he will continue to be forever, be there for us. Is this making sense to y'all? I want y'all to praise God if y'all got something from that word this morning. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Everybody standing with me if you possibly can. Hallelujah. Let's pray for social media. Father, in Jesus' name, I just speak life over each and every individual that's under the sound of my voice. God, we honor you for being the faithful Father that you are. And I just declare right now, Father, that the fruit of their labor is not in vain. And Lord, as I feel in my spirit, I want there's a specific minister. And I want each and every last one of us in this congregation, man. I want y'all to stretch out hands for me. There is a specific minister who is close to my heart that always tunes in. His name is Ira Cotton. And I want to pray for him right now through social media. Father, right now in the matchless name of Jesus, I lift Ira up to you, God. Your word declares in 2 Samuel chapter 20, verse 26, that Ira was a priest to David. Hey! So I declare right now in the matchless name, Father, that you infuse him with supernatural healing and wholeness, Father, from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. Your word says, Father, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So I thank you, Father, that strongholds are being broken. That he walks in the fullness of who you've called him to be. I bless you, Father, for your faithfulness over him. And I thank you for each and every person that is connected to him, that he shall live and not die to declare the works of the Lord. Father, we honor you and we bless you for your faithfulness in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Y'all praise God here if y'all got something.